Unfortunately, we have some change in the program for this next session. The next speaker should have been Yakir Aharonov, one of the legends in quantum mechanics from Tel Aviv. He was planning all the week last week to come here, but then on the day, more or less the day when he was supposed to leave, his doctor didn't allow him because he was not well. He's not a young person, as you know. And we're now trying to negotiate with him to send this talk via some link here. But we don't know if that will work out. So what we've done now is that we have another person missing, and that is Tony Leggett, who was supposed to talk tomorrow. We have his talk recorded, and we will show it in this session. But since that amounts to some computer work here, we will start with the next talk after Aharonov's, namely Jim Hartle's talk, and then after his talk, we will show Tony Leggett's talk. So please, Jim.
Thank you. I appreciate very much the invitation to speak with so many famous people around. Something a little bit daunting, but I'll do my best. Lars first asked me to give a historical review of the last 90 years of quantum mechanics. That's not something I can do. My scholarship is poor, right? My biases are significant, and it's only 40 minutes. So I'm going to do something else, basically tell you a little bit about the impact of cosmology on quantum mechanics. But I will organize it in a sort of quasi-historical way, which means we should begin with Copenhagen quantum mechanics. I don't think anybody would accept the statement that in the history of physics, Copenhagen quantum mechanics is the most successful theoretical framework that we've ever had. It has problems, according to some people, difficulties. You can see them sort of scattered around this word diagram. People had various issues. It's not entirely to me whether these problems are problems with the people or problems with quantum mechanics. But as far as I can tell, whatever the ambiguities were, in the entire 90 years of history, no mistakes have been made as a consequence of them. So we can wonder how important they are. Right then, though, at the time quantum mechanics was just getting started out, more or less to within the decade, there was another great revolution in physics, which was the discovery of the expansion of the universe, which meant that cosmology, right, was finally a really serious field. But Copenhagen quantum mechanics is not possible to deal with cosmology. First of all, there's no retrodiction in Copenhagen quantum mechanics. You can't construct probabilities for the past. Copenhagen quantum mechanics has two laws of evolution, unitary evolution by the Schrodinger equation. By the Schrodinger equation, that can be reversed. You can run that backward in time. But the other, the second law of evolution, is reduction of the wave packet, right? Where you have when you make a measurement, the state is then reduced by projecting on the measurement with its outcome and renormalizing it. That cannot be reversed. You don't know how many measurements were made in the past. Therefore, cosmology, however, is all about the past. We reconstruct from present data a history of the universe, right, in order to simplify our predictions of the future. But you can't do it in this form of quantum mechanics. All right. There were other reasons. So quantum mechanics has to be generalized to apply to cosmology because it assumed a division of the entire system into observer and observed. It assumed that the outcomes of measurements were the primary focus of science. And it assumed, as part and parcel of it, a classical world, right, which is outside the framework of the wave function and the Schrodinger equation. But in a theory of the whole thing, there can't be any fundamental division into observer and observed. There were no measurements. Measurements and observers can't be fundamental in a theory that seeks to describe the very early universe, whether or not around. And fundamentally, there were no variables of any kind that we would expect to behave classically in all circumstances. They're all quantum mechanical. So for these reasons, the theory had to be generalized. Such a generalization is important. It might even be important for elementary particle physics, because the characteristic scales, which today's fundamental theories are simplest, are the Planck scale, like string theory. And it's going to be, we have to, it seems unlikely, we're going to get laboratory experiments that probe that scale. It would be just too expensive. But we have one experiment that's already being done. That is, in the beginning of the expansion of the universe, we have an experiment that was already done where these energy scales were reached, and we have 14 gigayears of data and 42 light years scattered over 42 light years of space, and that means we can look to probe the theory by this experiment. That is, cosmology can be naturally the fundamental probe, right, of quantum mechanical theories that start in the very beginning. Well, what I'm going to tell you about is the evolution from Copenhagen quantum mechanics to decoherent hysteres quantum mechanics, which does not have these problems and is suitable for cosmology. So this is a brief history. Since I'm supposed to be brief, I'm only going to give you the endpoints of the history. It starts, I think, with Everett, 1957. It was his insight that the observers are not somehow outside the system looking at it. They're inside the universe. They're subject to the same laws of quantum mechanics as every other system, but they play no special role in the formulation of quantum mechanics. That's the starting point, I think. The ending point is here in decoherent hysteres quantum mechanics, which was the work of many people, but I have pictures up here for Robert Griffiths, Roland Omnes, and Murray Gell-Mann. And if you look there, I'm just going to try to operate the pointer unsuccessfully. All right. What? That's all right. Somehow I'm not working the pointer correctly. I did have one. All right. We don't really need a pointer. You'll notice this is not a particularly new theory. It's 30 years old, right? There is about the same time distance between Heisenberg and Everett as there is between Everett and decoherent hysteres quantum mechanics at about the same time until today. So this is sometimes doesn't, what's this? Oh, we have to, there's an on switch. I still know, there it is, yeah. Okay, Griffiths on the scale man and so forth. And by now, it's a standard enough theory that it appears in elementary quantum mechanical textbooks. Like this recent one by Weinberg, you can find a whole exposition and a chapter of decoherent hysteres quantum mechanics straight down the party line, I'm pleased to say. So that's what I'm going to describe in very brief terms to you. For the purpose of this discussion, I'm just going to consider a model quantum universe in a box. Imagine that there's a very big box, maybe 20,000 megaparsecs on the side, containing everything, containing stars, galaxies, the sun, right? You, me, everything else is inside the box. There's nothing outside, right, that's looking at it. The theoretical inputs to doing calculations that are assumed are a theory of the dynamics, the Hamiltonian, and a theory of the quantum state. And from that, we're supposed to calculate probabilities for what happens in the universe and for what we observe of it. Now, the most general objective of quantum theory is the prediction of probabilities for histories of things, sequences of events in time. For example, there's the history of the moon as we, as this looks like the Earth. The history of the Earth as it goes around the sun. According to quantum mechanics, it's not necessary that it goes along a Keplerian orbit. It's only in the ensemble of possible orbits, the Keplerian orbit in the situation the Earth is in has an overwhelmingly high probability. So that's the prediction of history, probabilities for histories of one object. In cosmology, we're interested in the history of the universe, right? The past. And now we can overcome the difficulty with Copenhagen quantum mechanics, because decoherent quantum mechanics does permit retrodiction. We can have probabilities for what happened in the past, given present records can be calculated by using histories that extend from the present into the past and doing those calculations. So decoherent histories, an equipment change, I guess. Decoherent history enables quantum cosmology. That means the past is not certain, the past is probabilistic. I asked Don Howard, who was a scholar of the Copenhagen era, had they ever thought about the past at all? He said only one person thought about the past, and that was Einstein. And here's a quote from his paper in the Physical Review, Einstein told Monopolowski, "The principles of quantum mechanics must involve an uncertainty in the description of past events analogous to the uncertainty in the prediction of the future ones." And that's correct. I'm now going to describe to you decoherent histories in three or four very simple slides, right? I'm not getting beyond the two-slit experiment. The chief thing to know, which is that interference is an obstacle to predicting histories in quantum mechanics. Suppose we have a two-slit experiment. An electron gun emits an electron here. It can go through one of two slits, upper slits and lower slits, and arrives at point Y on the screen. There are two obvious histories of this system. It arrived at Y, one history when it went through the upper slit, and one history where it went through the lower slit. But we can't assign it'd be inconsistent to assign probabilities to those histories, because in quantum mechanics, probabilities are squares of amplitudes, and the amplitude to arrive at Y is the sum of the amplitudes to go through the upper slit and arrive at Y, and the lower slit to arrive at Y. And the square of the sum is not equal to the sums of the squares, because these two terms interfere, right? Therefore, it's inconsistent to assign probabilities to the set of alternative histories. That is the consistency. But now consider another two-slit experiment. Oh, this just says the same thing. So some rule is needed to specify which histories can be assigned probabilities and which cannot. We can assign probabilities in textbook quantum mechanics only to sets of histories that have been measured. If you had the same thing in Copenhagen quantum mechanics with a two-slit experiment, you would say you couldn't assign those probabilities because we didn't measure which slit it went through. But we're not interested in measurement in cosmology. We're interested in the early universe where there wasn't any. So textbook quantum mechanics assign probabilities only to sets of histories that were measured. In decoherent histories assigns probabilities, the sets of histories that decohere, i.e. for which there's negligible interference between the histories as between members of a set as a consequence of the system's Hamiltonian. So decoherent histories predicts consistent probabilities. So that we're already two words in, decoherent histories, quantum mechanics. Decoherence histories, decoherence is a more general, more observer-independent rule for assigning probabilities than measurement. We can assign quantum probabilities to the position of the moon when no one is looking at it, and to density fluctuations in the early universe when there are no observers around to measure them. Here's a slightly different situation where the two histories do decohere. Imagine that in the vicinity of the two slits, there was a gas of particles that were interacting with the electron. They were interacting weakly, so they didn't affect the motion of the electron very much. Then this gas constitutes what's called in this business an environment. So for as we've already mentioned, for any given point of arrival on the screen, we have two branch state vectors, one where it went through the upper slit, the history, went through the upper slit and arrived at y, and when it went through the lower slit and arrived at y. The measure of interference is the overlap between those two, like this. So you can assign probabilities when this interference vanishes between different histories. So the condition for decoherence and probabilities is that this measure of interference should just be diagonal in the slits and in the point y, right? The other side of this is the probabilities for those histories when they do decohere. Here's an actual calculation. Suppose we have the initial state here, which is a superposition of going through the upper slit and the lower slit, and a bunch of these states for the gas particle. That evolves into a sum of two branch state vectors with a little time, where various particles, if they went through the upper slit, are characterized, scattered by an S matrix that acts on the initial state from the others, scattering off the upper slit and scattering from a vicinity of the lower slit for the others. If you take the overlap between these two, you get the original overlap, but you also get this large factor of overlap between SU and SL. You get this to the product of N. These are two different vectors, therefore the norm is less than one. And if you take a very large number of particles, the interference goes to zero because of those interactions. Decoherence is widespread in the universe. In the classic example of Yosin-Se, if you have one dust grain out in interstellar space in a superposition of two positions, I'd like some advice from anybody that knows how to draw a superposition. This is one dust grain in a superposition of two positions, 1 millimeter apart. The relative phases between those two situations dissipate in about a nanosecond simply from the scattering of the 3-degree black body radiation, the 10 to the 11th photons that scatter off them every second. So it's something you can calculate in the right physical situation. Measured alternatives decohere. That's because in a typical measurement situation, like this two-slit experiment in a box, if you measured which slit the electron went through by some apparatus, it becomes correlated with some bigger piece of apparatus outside that decoheres because of its position in the universe. So measurements always are always decoherent. Copenhagen quantum mechanics is therefore an approximation to decoherent histories quantum mechanics suitable for measurement situations. So it's not an alternative, right, to quantum mechanics, to decoherence quantum mechanics. It's contained within it as a special approximation for a special type of physical situations. The Copenhagen people were right, but they were right not for the universe, but for a special kind of measurement situations. We're still far away from mimicking cosmology in the laboratory, but it's not inconceivable that we could have a double slit situation in which we could send members of this audience through the two slits with detectors for radiation and see what came out at the other end. It's too bad Tony Leggett isn't here. He would tell us the situation of them. Once you see that Copenhagen quantum mechanics is a is an approximation to a more general theory, at least for me, the so-called problems seem much less serious, right? We don't have to define what a measurement is exactly mathematically. It can be like so many other, like defining what is life, right? Well, we know life when we see it, and we know measurements when we see it, but we don't have to have a definite mathematical definition. But there's one lacuna here. Remember that the Copenhagen theory posited a kind of quasi-classical realm. That is the classical world, they called it. That's a true experimental fact. Here we are in this room dealing with a coarse graining. If you don't posit that, as they did, then you have to explain it in the context of decoherent histories, quantum mechanics. Okay, first we have to say what we mean by classicality. We're dealing with histories. So a system like the Earth going around the Sun behaves classically when the probability is high for histories that exhibit deterministic correlations of time. You can see the origin of this very roughly. I'm going to run through a series. This may not be completely clear to everyone, but here's how the quasi-classical realm emerges. First, the state of the universe and the quantum and quantum gravity have to imply that there's classical space-time, right? Obeying the Einstein equations. Once you have classical space-time, then you have local Lorentz invariants, local Lorentz symmetries, and then you have conservation laws of energy, momentum, number. Sets of histories defined by averages of densities of these conserved quantities over small volumes can be shown to decohere in appropriate coarse grainings. Approximate conservation implies that these quasi-classical variables are predictable, that is, they obey equations, despite the noise from the interactions that make the decoherence. Local equilibrium implies closed sets of equations of motion, like the Navier-Stokes equations, and that's how we get all of classical physics. Okay, shift gears a little bit. If we're going to take the cosmological point of view, and the universe is a quantum mechanical system, it has a quantum state. What is it? That is the central question of quantum cosmology. It's a question that has to be answered because if you're ignorant of the state, if you don't specify the state, then you have no predictions at all, because in quantum mechanics, just calculating an ordinary probability is a product of the state and some operator representing the alternative. If you don't have both, you don't have any probabilities at all. You can't say you're ignorant of the state because ignorance means that you should calculate with a density matrix equal to 1. But a density matrix equal 1 has no evolution, infinite temperature equilibrium, no second law of thermodynamics, and no classical fluctuation because the fluctuations are all, no classical behavior because all the fluctuations are large, all inconsistent with observation. So contemporary final theories, at least if they're quantum mechanical, necessarily consist of two parts. A theory of the dynamics, which might be string theory, and a theory of the initial state of the universe, which I'll say here aside. I think my intuition suggests that there's an unfinished task of unification here, but for the moment, we've got them separate. So we can ask a simple question: which regularities of the universe that we see arise mostly from the Hamiltonian, and which from the state? Here's a little list, biased list, I have to say, but from the Hamiltonian, it's mostly regularities in time, right? Evolutionary laws, laboratory experiments, classical dynamics, et cetera. From the state follow mostly regularities that are in space, the existence of classical spacetime in the first place. I should have said, but it's the combination that's in general, but mostly the early homogeneity and isotropy, plus the amount of inflation, the fact that the fluctuations in the universe seem to start from the ground state, as Professor Mukhanov will explain to you presumably later today. The arrows of time, right? Low entropy early, higher entropy later. The CMB, the existence of isolated systems. In the early universe, there aren't any isolated systems. They emerge just like everything else. The topology of space-time may be the number of large and small dimensions, the number of time dimensions, and the coupling constants of affected theories. So there's a lot of stuff which is explained, right, or can be explained in the context of the rights and the state, notion of the state tested. A simple example of a theory of the quantum state is Hawking's no-boundary wave function of the universe. I'm not going to describe that in any detail. I'll just rapidly say something for people that might understand it. Wave functions in cosmology are functions of three geometry and three-dimensional matter field configurations. The no-boundary wave function is a sum of the Euclidean action of the four-dimensional configurations. If you want the wave function at a given three-dimensional place in its configuration space, you take a geometry that has four-dimensional geometry that has one boundary on which the three-dimensional geometry is G, and then you sum over all the four-dimensional geometries that match that with no other boundary. In the semi-classical approximation, they're just given by e to the minus the action of the saddle points of the Euclidean action. So what you get out from this wave function is probabilities for what happens in the universe. As you have a set of alternative histories, so you get different amounts of inflation, right? And then you get probabilities for the amount of inflation. But what we wanted, probabilities for our observations. Probabilities for observations are the probabilities for what happens, conditioned on the fact that the history has to contain representation of us. That is, it's conditioned on our observational data, that as Bohr said, specifies the observational situation. For example, the question, what does your theory predict for the temperature of the microwave background doesn't make any sense because the temperature of the microwave background varies in time. You have to say, at what time did you measure it, right, in order, distance from the Big Bang, in order to get a definite prediction. That's a condition on data. But it has an important consequence, which is that if that's the predictions for our observations, then anthropic reasoning is automatic in quantum cosmology. Because we won't observe what is where we cannot exist. If the observational our observational situation, us, can't exist in, for example, in a universe with a very high cosmological constant, then we won't observe. So anthropic reasoning is not a principle. It's not a postulate. It's not a separate thing. It just follows automatically from calculating probabilities for observations. Well, now I'll illustrate this with a calculation of the cosmological constant done with many assumptions. Any quantum mechanical theory generates a multiverse, as I would define it, that is, a set of alternatives, only one of which we observe. But a simple, manageable, discoverable quantum state of the universe will not predict a unique classical history, because if it did, it would have to encode in the initial condition all the present complexity, exactly which of you sat in which of these chairs. To have a simple, rather, it predicts an ensemble of possible histories with probabilities that can be highly distributed. My teacher, Mary Gell-Mann, used to ask me, if you know the wave function of the universe, why aren't you rich? The answer is, right, the wave function of the universe does predict probabilities for whether the stock market will go up or down tomorrow, but I don't know the real answer, but I'm pretty sure it's 50-50 that it's going to go up. No useful information. Okay. But suppose the constants vary from history and history. So here's an example. I'm just going to write down a simple scalar field potential as a model of the matter. Suppose we have a potential, which is shares something in part with string theory, in that there are many local minima, many vacua. These local minima have different cosmological constants and different quadratic pieces down at the bottom. The cosmological constant, the mass, is connected with the amplitude of the primordial density fluctuations when they leave their horizon, enough for this purpose. The probability that we observe values lambda and q is a historical question. It's the probability of whether we roll down to one minimum or the other. But that's a historical question, a statement about histories. Which history, what is the probability we roll down one of these histories or the other? That translates into a probability of the cosmological constant and the amplitude of the density fluctuations. But as I mentioned, we can only have ones that are consistent with our observational situation. That's called anthropic limits. Here's the anthropic constraints on lambda and q as calculated by Tedmark et al. So here's log q going up this way, log lambda going up that way. If lambda is too big, the acceleration it provides is too large, and you don't form halos of galaxies. No galaxies over here for these large values. If q is too large, well, you get a lot of black holes. If we put in the age, a collapse by, say, 10 to the 11th, 11 gigayears, you get a nice circle like this, right? We have to live in here someplace. But the no-boundary wave function will tell us where we live. Approximately, it gives you a probability for lambda and n that's given by this. Or since lambda is so small in that range, it's essentially 2 pi over q. It favors very low original fluctuations. That's because the essential ingredient in the theory is the wave function. It's, the probabilities are e to the minus the action. Fluctuations cause action, they're suppressed. So we go to the lowest value we can here, and you get q 10 to the minus 5 and 10 to the minus 123, which are not too bad. Is that a great success of the theory? I wouldn't say so. We didn't calculate anything else. Yeah, skip that. We notice that anthropic selection depends on Everett, right? It depends on us being in the universe. We won't see the other universes, as people sometimes worry about in multiverses. Schrodinger's cat does not see the dead cat. Large or infinite universe requires symmetries, and quantum mechanics is a natural vehicle for that. But if everything is quantum mechanical, space-time geometry is also quantum mechanical. And I want to describe a little bit about that. We're not talking about quantum mechanics in the box, but quantum mechanics of the box. Familiar quantum theory assumes a fixed space-time. It needs that just to define the T in the Schrodinger equation. Right? Where does that come from? It's a geometrical statement, or to define the space-like surface on which the wave function is reduced. The key idea if you have, imagine kind of Feynman sum over histories, if you sum over different geometries, if you have two points, in some geometries they may be space-like separated, in some geometries they may be time-like separated. just thought I would slow this. I've shown you one success of the no boundary wave function. I'm not going to explore these, but here is a list of the other ones. In very simple models, we predict classical Lorentzian in space-time, early homogeneity and isotropy, plus inflation, fluctuations that start in their ground state, which is consistent with the CMB, arrows of time, in the sense that we predict low entropy going into high entropy, isolated systems from the condensation of the action fluctuations collapsing under the action of gravitational attractions. I don't think we're doing too well yet on these other things, the topology, the space-time, the number of dimensions, number of time dimensions, some hints, right? But it's a work in progress. Decoherent histories, quantum mechanics is logically consistent with experiment as far as it's known, consistent with the rest of modern physics, which is an important thing, like special relativity, quantum field theory, and it's generalizable to quantum gravity, only I haven't showed you that. It may not be the only formulation with these properties, but it's the only one we have now. But I think we have to, there's a reason for thinking we have to get beyond decoherent quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics was not written on the tablets of Moses. Applying quantum mechanics to the universe is a truly vast extrapolation from the microscopic to the macroscopic. The founders of quantum mechanics thought indeterminacy and complementarity arose from the limitations of measurement. Well, why would we have those in a closed system that is never measured? Why the principle of superposition in a theory where there is only one state? Also, some of our deepest thinkers, one of whom is nodded off in the front row, right, have all told us, right, that there has to be something beyond quantum mechanics. Alternatives and extensions of the decoherent histories would be great interest, if only to motivate the experiment. And there are many candidates. I haven't, Kavanaugh and won't go into them. The economy of decoherent histories makes it a natural candidate for generalizations. Okay, that's my talk. I'll just conclude with, we'll wait and see, with a recap of what the main points were. The modern formulation of quantum mechanics, decoherent histories, helps us understand the Copenhagen formulation of quantum mechanics. A measurement situation is an approximation to a bigger and more simply formulated theory. It helps us understand our universe both now and at the beginning when there was no observers. It helps us understand the nature of final theories, which have to consist of two parts at present, theory of dynamics and a theory of the state. Our place in the universe as observers, not outside looking at it, but inside as physical systems, which have a negligible effect on the whole universe. But we can calculate for those negligible systems what the probabilities were that they will observe something, and multiverses, anthropic selection, and maybe alternatives to modern quantum mechanics. Thank you very much. Well, I left a lot of time for questions.
What? Thank you. Thank you, Jim, for this wonderful talk. I'm sure there are many questions. And of course, some of you younger people might not be brave enough to ask this question. You can always ask questions outside, you know, just grab the speaker, don't be afraid. But now we start with some more braver people here.
I have a question about this statement that entropic reasoning follows from quantum mechanics. So you had this picture with cosmological constant lambda and density fluctuations from Tegmark et al. And there was a region which was called no galaxies. And so the...
Not many halos.
Right. So... right, but the question is the following. What this region actually means, that there are not many galaxies? Basically, you have density fluctuations, which is a Gaussian field. And in that regime, these fluctuations become more and more rare as you go deeper in that region. However, for any value of the cosmological constant, let's say 1,000 or 10,000 times greater than the observed, you still have fluctuations large enough to form galaxies.
Okay. So I was taking, I didn't say it correctly, the view as part of the data, that, on which these conditions were made, a universe full of galaxies.
Well, full of galaxies.
Well, that's our data. And in general, we have...
There is a finite probability for that, too, that our observed region will somehow...
Well, inside our Hubble body.
Yeah.
I view this, the story of prediction like this, roughly, maybe this will help. At any one time, we have a certain amount of data in cosmology, more or less all at one time, compared to the time the universe is evolving. We test whatever theory we have of the wave function and the dynamics by dividing the data into two parts, right? Parts which we assume, and then parts which we seek to predict. That is, we look for correlations in the data as it exists, right? When more correlations, we think the better theory. So in principle, I should take all the data. In my example, I only took a little bit.
You know that we are only 5% of the content of the universe. Suppose we go to the dark sector of the universe, and suppose they're having a conference in their own dark Singapore, and Professor Jim Hartle from some University of Santa Barbara, dark sector of the universe, is giving a similar talk, and he's talking about anthropic principle. Would he say the same things as you say you're telling us? Because I have a feeling that we are making ourselves much too important to impose anthropic principle, because after all, we are a tiny little minority, and I can't understand why the universe should have been created for us.
I agree with you on this. I think what you're expressing is, how could some tiny little system affect the universe? It does not, right? Your intuition is correct. In the probabilities predicted by the wave function, we're just a little minor fluctuation. But we're not only interested in those probabilities, we're interested in probabilities for what we as particular systems observe. And those probabilities are conditioned on a description of all the people in this room, or tiny little fluctuations in the universe. Your intuition, which I think is correct, is people, they can't have any effect on the big universe, and I don't think they do. So what we call the third person's probabilities predicted just by the state and the Hamiltonian doesn't much care whether we have the... What we observe as particular instances, as in the temperature of the microwave background example, do depend strongly on our observational situation, our place in the universe.
So how small do the interference terms have to be before we say that one either can assign or cannot assign a coherent history? That's one question. I mean, you had these squiggly lines, approximately zero, I guess, so much less than one. And also, what precludes the possibility of imagining changing the dynamics in the future, which allows for recoherence of those two branches, which you had presumed couldn't recohere because the interference terms at one particular time are very, very small?
Yes. Okay, that's two questions. How small does it have to be? There's always some slop in probability theory, right, in my opinion.
we act depending, for example, to reject theories when probabilities for their predictions are sufficiently high, and we didn't see them. What value we pick for them is a matter of what the competing theories are. So there isn't any strict answer. But if you do the calculations, right, for interference.
It's not a strict answer, not a strict theory.
Yeah, so I would say it's not a strict theory, okay. However, the theory can be reformulated, right? I haven't done that here, such that it's free from this ambiguity, right? Not in this way, but so that there's only one real history, and the probabilities emerge, right, roughly as in the Gibbs ensemble, right? So that's something Murray and I did. I'm not expecting you to understand that. But see, the second thing was?
Recoherence.
Oh, recoherence. Of course, it can be recohered. So decoherence is a property of a set of histories, not just a simple fact. So if you have a history in which the thing recoheres, for example, if intelligent aliens are even now poised to recohere all the histories which we think and what we did in different states of the room, right, then they won't be able to predict the same past, retrodict the same past, because they will have recohered it all. Probably we're not going to like the process of recoherence very much. Depends on what the histories are. Only what the histories are. If the histories only go up to a certain time, it doesn't depend on the future in the usual story where we don't have final conditions. Why is that confusing? There's a history up to now.
You may say that these two histories
I don't think so. Well, what if it were true that everything that we see now was going to be recohered in the future by some experiment which I just described? I don't think it would make any difference to what we do, because we're not using that set of histories. The theory exhibits a whole lot of set of histories. The decoherence is decided one by one. I saw you grimacing during that.
Yeah. So, Jim, imagine, okay, decoherence is always approximate for the closed system, right? If you don't have infinite reservoir. So, let's imagine the situation that at a certain time, for instance, the resolution of our devices is below the level of decoherence, right? Then
I'm,
we can.
Sorry, I'm having a little trouble with the.
Sorry. Okay, so.
No, it's not your fault. I think you're loud enough, but I have to.
Yeah, let's let's imagine that at a certain point, the resolution of our devices is not high enough, so we can consider two histories which decohere. So, when we cannot measure any kind of interference effect. But then let's wait for some time. Technology improved. And between similar trajectories, we can see interference effect. Would you call in this case the other history as realistic as our history? Because it influences on us, yeah? So in this sense, the question is, okay, should we pick up just one of the coherent histories and call its reality, or we have to consider all decoherent histories as reality? You know to which direction I'm trying to move you, yeah? To Everett, right?
Yeah, it's not going to work. any rate, with regard to reality, right, we have Tony Leggett, right, in the next, whose title at least involved realism. But the past is not over and done with. As there are many different decoherent sets of decoherence in the future, so there are many different decoherent sets in the past, right? It depends on, some of them are more coarse-grained than others, have less information. The past is not over and done with in one sense, right? It depends on what you condition the past on. If you keep on going, the past is a possibility of changing. Now, of course, in ordinary cosmology, I don't think you're going to recohere, you know, two branches of the space-time geometry of the whole thing. So it's okay. Or let's put it this way, right? Classical physics, which is what we use for the most part in cosmology, with a little tiny quantum fluctuations, on it, right, allows us to extrapolate into the past. I think it'd be very hard to sort of arrange a situation in which they, to have a situation now in which we could engineer some situation in which they didn't decohere.
Yeah.
Other questions?
Let's
How about questions from the back? What about the back?
Please, what would happen if there is an external observer just at the beginning of the universe to the wave function? This is the first question. And the second one, what happens also if there is an external observer during, just after the Big Bang?
Well, that's how I got into this game, right? I was interested in cosmology. I had a theory of the quantum state. And yet, what the theory of quantum mechanics told me was that the probabilities I was calculating for density fluctuations in the very early universe were the probabilities that if somebody had been around at the time that the universe was a Pion-Compton wavelength and size, that's the answer they would have gotten. There aren't any observers in the early universe, we believe. No observers in the beginning. It's implausible. The temperature was too high. Right? It's a mess. So we need a theory that doesn't make that assumption. And that's what decoherent histories is all about.
Okay. I think we have to stop this lecture now. And but as I said, all the younger people, also if there are younger people in the other room, don't be afraid to ask questions to the lecturers. That's what they are here for.